Contour Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Pitbull, The Battle Over an American Icon by Bronwen Dickey, narrated by Randye, Kaye. Neither a man, nor a crowd, nor a nation can be trusted to act humanely or to think sanely under the influence of a great fear. Bertrand Russell. Author's Note. This book is the culmination of 7 years of research that took me across 15 states, during which I interviewed more than 350 people, including pet owners, dog breeders, dog trainers, animal control officers, animal rescuers, conformation judges, shelter workers, cruelty investigators, animal advocates, law enforcement officers, and dog bite victims, as well as experts in veterinary medicine, animal behavior, canine genetics, constitutional and criminal law, public policy, risk analysis, and public health epidemiology. I also attended multiple conformation shows, animal welfare conferences, law enforcement training seminars, and community outreach events, and read many thousands of pages of scientific journal articles, legal depositions, police and coroner's reports, and archival materials that spanned more than 250 years. When it has been necessary for me to recreate past events, I have drawn most heavily from primary sources, including contemporaneous news coverage, letters, diaries, photographs, incident reports, and other public documents. If key participants were still alive, I contacted them for verification whenever possible. In some cases, multiple days or weeks' worth of interviews and follow-ups have been condensed for easier reading, but quotations have been fact-checked with sources or checked against the transcripts of recorded conversations. Many people on all sides of the Pitbull debate will disagree with what I have written here. Breeders, in particular, will argue with me about which dogs count as pit bulls, as they do so often among themselves. I have included the breeds in this group that are most closely related and physically similar, with full understanding that some of those breeds have changed over time. While a growing number of animal advocates prefer the word guardian to owner when referring to humans and their canine companions, I have chosen to use the latter term because of its current legal accuracy. I do not claim that this book encapsulates everything there is to know about pit bulls, but I do hope that my efforts in the following pages will contribute to a much larger dialogue about human-animal relationships in America. Please be advised that some of the material and several of the images in this book are graphic in nature. A few last names have been omitted to protect the privacy of certain people. Any factual errors are entirely my own. Prologue. There are very few monsters who warrant the fear we have of them. André Gide, Les Nouvelles Nourritures. The sky had just begun to darken when the Smoke family stopped for gas in Davidson County, Tennessee. It was the first day of 2003, and James Smoke, his wife of 12 years, Pamela, his 17-year-old stepson, Brandon, and the family's two dogs, Patton and Cassie, had just finished a vacation in Nashville. They were now headed home to Saluda, North Carolina, as part of a two-car caravan, with James's parents and the Smoke's two younger children bringing up the rear. Inserting a credit card with one hand, James needed the other to operate the gas pump, so he tossed his wallet onto the roof of his green station wagon as he filled the tank, then climbed back into the car without retrieving it. A few minutes later, when a patrol car flashed its lights and directed him to pull over onto the shoulder of I-40, Smoke reached into his pocket and realized his wallet was missing. Assuming this was a standard-issue traffic stop, James and Pamela were more annoyed than concerned. When three additional cruisers from the Tennessee Highway Patrol and the Cookeville, Tennessee Police Department arrived, however, both grew nervous. A patrolman shouted instructions at Smoke. He was to drop his keys out of the window, get out of the car with his hands raised, and walk backward toward the rear of the vehicle. Bewildered, James did as he'd been told. Once he reached the back of the station wagon and kneeled down as directed, an officer ordered him to put his hands behind his back. Another policeman trained an assault rifle on him, and a third cinched handcuffs around his wrists. Pamela and Brandon were then instructed to get out, kneel, and put their hands behind their backs to be cuffed as well. One of the officers informed James that the local police dispatcher had been notified of a possible robbery in the area. James and his family were the primary, in fact, the only, suspects. Insisting that he was not involved and knew nothing about it, James stopped his protest mid-sentence when he noticed the wagon's open passenger door. Pamela had forgotten to nudge it closed when she got out. "Hey, wait," James shouted at the officers. "I've got dogs in the car, and I don't want them to run into the road." The officer's 25-minute dash cam recording of these events would later be submitted into evidence as part of a formal investigation into police procedure. Around the video's 3-minute mark, Patton, whom the family described as a brindle pit bull boxer mix, bounds out of the wagon with his tail wagging. At 55 pounds, he is smaller than most Labradors. If Patton growls or barks, none of the officers' microphones pick it up. Then Officer Eric Hall of the Cookeville Police Department shoulders his 12-gauge shotgun. The family members who are kneeling next to one another in the bright glare of the police car's lights begin to scream, their voices merging into a single panicked chorus. "No!" Pamela begs Hall on the recording. "No! No!" Hall fires his weapon at close range, killing the animal instantly. James springs to his feet. "You shot my dog," he bellows at the officers. "God damn it! Oh, my God! Oh, my God!" Two of the patrolmen tackle Smoke, pinning the man to the ground. They order a hysterical Pamela, who has also jumped up, back to her knees. The family's wailing sobs overwhelm the audio. Finally, the officers shove James, Pamela, and Brandon into two separate patrol cars and await the dispatcher's instructions. Within the hour, the officers would learn over the radio that no robbery had occurred. A female driver in a passing car had seen dollar bills from James's wallet fluttering away from the Smoke station wagon and called the Tennessee Highway Patrol to report a possible holdup. After a volley of calls between the Highway Patrol and the police dispatchers, both departments sent officers on a felony traffic stop, the kind reserved for drug traffickers and those suspected of violent crimes, despite having few details. Once the mix-up had been relayed to them, the policeman sheepishly uncuffed the Smoke family, apologized, and told them they were free to go. Brandon crawled over to Patton's lifeless body and cradled it as he cried. His stepfather then wrapped the dog in the only item he could use as a makeshift shroud, a plastic bag, and placed him in the back of the wagon. James Smoke later said that he was so emotionally distraught over the shooting that Pamela took him to the nearest hospital emergency department for severe chest pain. He would also undergo surgery for a knee injury he said was incurred when the officers threw their weight into him. For Hall, a professed animal lover who holds a degree in wildlife law enforcement, the presence of a brindle pit bull in the Smoke's car fit into the dangerous criminal narrative. Pit bulls, he believed, did not behave like other dogs. Though he admitted that the dog had been out of the car for only 3 seconds, this was the version of events Hall recounted in his internal affairs interview. "Officer Eric Hall, this dog jumps out of the car, the suspect car, and I believe it's a full-grown pit bull. I'm the officer furthest to the right, and it circles around, and I even see Officer McWhorter, a fellow patrolman, kind of track the dog with his weapon, and then come back up, and that dog's coming right at me. I mean, it just singled me out. Here it comes charging and growling, definitely an aggressive posture and stance it was taking, trying to circle me. I yelled at the dog, and I yelled, I know, once, real loud, for it to get back. Scare it, something, get it, just get back off of me. And no effect at all, and it was trying to get round me, and it was probably 2 foot from the muzzle of my shotgun, and trying to get at me, and I fired one time at the dog, put the dog down." Detective Sergeant Bill Bowman, When a pit bull is on the attack, what mannerisms do they have? Hall. He was sidestepping, trying to come at me, growling, kind of hunched like he was going to spring up at me and so forth. Bowman. Did you feel that the dog was stalking you? Hall. Oh, yeah. Bowman. Okay, and your knowledge of pit bulls is that they are extremely dangerous? Hall. Yes. Bowman. They have killed people before? Hall. Yes. Officer Meade McWhorter backed up his colleague. Shooting the dog was the only option. The pit bull had been large and menacing, 65 or 75 pounds. In other words, big enough to bite you. McWhorter explained, there's 2,000 pounds per square inch in a dog bite. I don't know that I would take the chance on it. The Internal Affairs Board concurred with Hall and McWhorter, deciding that Hall was placed in a position that a reasonable person would have believed that he was in imminent danger of serious bodily harm or death. This was not the first time Hall had encountered dogs in the line of duty. Before the smoke incident, he had shot two others in, quote, self-defense. When asked why he did not use mace, a taser, or a nightstick to protect himself, Hall replied, mace doesn't work on animals as well as it does on people, and both my hands were full with the shotgun. You can't try to kick a dog or be jumping around with a loaded shotgun in your hand. The judge who presided over the smoke's lawsuit and the officer's subsequent appeals did not see it that way. In fact, she excoriated members of the Cookeville PD for, quote, prowling around the family and pointing both a shotgun and an assault rifle at them in the first place, rather than keeping their weapons in the customary down-ready position. Although this gesture was superficially menacing and surely intended as an intimidating show of force, the judge wrote in her formal opinion, the way these two officers paced and shuffled behind the troopers, wavering guns gripped white-knuckled in their hands, exhibits such nervousness and fear that, even on video, the tension is palpable and the ensuing events are almost predictable. The mere presence of a pit bull caused Eric Hall such anxiety that he abandoned his professional training, his good judgment, and his common sense in the line of duty. On the evening of January 1, 2003, he didn't see a family dog at all. He saw a monster. Chapter 1. Pariah Dogs. The animal has secrets which, unlike the secrets of caves, mountains, seas, are specifically addressed to man. John Berger, Why Look at Animals? All knowledge, the totality of all questions and answers, is contained in the dog. Franz Kafka, Investigations of a Dog. On a hot summer day a few years ago, my husband Sean brought home Nola, a slightly underweight 38-pound pit bull with a caramel and white coat, a pink nose, and eyes the color of honey. Pronounced cheek muscles and a cleft in the top of her head gave her face the shape of a small but eager heart. When Sean and I visited our city's animal shelter earlier that month, I had barely noticed her. Wait a minute, he said as I cooed over a flashier and more extroverted candidate. What about this one? When she glued herself to Sean's legs in the shelter's play yard, we agreed to give her a home. We did not need another dog. We had been married less than a year, and we still did not know how best to shape our independent selves to the contours of a shared life. Sean worked long hours at a local hospital, and I spent weeks away from home on reporting assignments. Oscar, our imperious black pug, had finally gotten to the age where we no longer worried about leaving him alone in the house, and not worrying was an activity I had come to enjoy. Any new addition would put a large speed bump in our otherwise smooth routine. I'm still not sure why we did it, but I do remember an unnerving sense of recognition when she looked at me through her chain-link kennel. It was a feeling I had never experienced before and haven't since. I can't say that she stared at me exactly, but she never looked away either. Somewhere underneath that look was a spark of intense curiosity. It was a look with layers. In his classic essay, Why Look at Animals?, the critic John Berger writes that the look between man and animal is one of enormous weight. It is a bridge between our species and theirs, one of the few that can be built between creatures that do not share a common language. The animal scrutinizes man across a narrow abyss of non-comprehension, Berger says. When a man looks back, however, he is always looking across ignorance and fear. I did not feel fear in the presence of this particular dog, but hundreds of news reports about dog attacks told me that I had good reason to fear her kind. For almost 40 years, the media have recycled a seductively simple narrative about dangerous breeds that relies on terrifying anecdotes and a vocal minority of people who have declared themselves, quote, experts. Those closest to me were quick to express their reservations about adopting a pit bull. "I wouldn't do it," one woman told me solemnly. "Those dogs will turn on you, and once the aggression switch is turned on, there's no turning it off." Another lowered her voice and said she assumed certain things about people who own pit bulls. She did not need to elaborate. I understood that she assumed pit bull owners were either criminally inclined or otherwise morally suspect, but my friends who wrung their hands had never physically encountered these dogs. They were not even sure how to identify them. Even so, they believed they knew the pit bull's story, into which was written a long legacy of human bloodlust and betrayal, hardline genetic determinism, and unprovoked animal rage. Our popular culture is saturated with these stereotypes, and they are highly profitable for corporations and celebrities looking to cultivate an image of toughness. In 2003, Nike ignited a media firestorm when it released a television ad that cut images of chained pit bulls lunging at each other into footage of basketball face-offs between the NBA superstars Tony Parker, Jason Kidd, Gary Payton, and Steve Nash. The company was adamant that it never intended to encourage dogfighting, only to capture what it called the edginess of urban basketball. Likewise, in 2012, when a reporter for GQ magazine asked the Cuban-American rapper Armando Perez about the origins of his stage name, Pitbull, the artist replied, "In dog fights, pit bulls are too stupid to lose," a muddled way of saying that the dogs use their hearts more than their heads, and their hearts know only how to fight. But images of pit bulls as snarling beasts are by no means limited to urban iconography. Take a walk through any American shopping center, and you are likely to find pit bull sunglasses, pit bull soccer cleats, pit bull tires, pit bull colognes, even pit bull energy drinks, wines, and hot sauces, all of which trade on the idea of a Nietzschean Uberhund who won't back down or won't let go. Some of our most common metaphors invoke the days of animal combat as well. The terms top dog and underdog both originated in the fighting pits. When the Republican vice presidential candidate Sarah Palin joked during her 2008 acceptance speech that the only difference between a hockey mom and a pit bull was lipstick, the audience laughed knowingly. The irony of this is that many who valorize the stereotype, who proudly identify themselves as pit bull politicians, pit bull lawyers, pit bull stock traders, vilify the actual dogs at the center of it. But which dogs are those? The term pit bull is an elastic, imprecise, and subjective phrase. At its narrower end, it denotes one breed, the American Pit Bull Terrier, APBT, which originated as a fighting dog in Massachusetts in 1889. A century later, American lawyers and politicians expanded the term to include the American Staffordshire Terrier, Amstaff, the APBT's preppy kennel club cousin, and the Staffordshire Bull Terrier, Stafford, a pint-sized variant of the 19th-century British fighting dog that is now primarily bred for confirmation shows in its native United Kingdom. In 2013, one more breed was added to this already diverse group when the United Kennel Club, UKC, formally recognized the American Bully, a heavier conformation and companion dog derived from the Amstaff in the 1990s. Dogs from these four breeds can weigh anywhere from 25 to 100 pounds, with most about 40 to 50, and come in at least 16 different coat colors and patterns. Ask 100 different Americans to define what a pit bull is, however, and you will get 100 different answers. Over the past two decades, the category has swelled to include mixed-breed dogs that possess supposed pit bull characteristics, such as blocky heads, white chest markings, or brindle coats. Those same characteristics can be found in more than 20 breeds of dog, and the latest genetic research indicates that many mixed-breed dogs identified as pit mixes actually aren't. Pit bull, as it is most commonly used, has become a slapdash shorthand for a general shape of a dog, a medium-sized, smooth-coated mutt, or a dog not otherwise specified. Most of the 77 million dogs thought to be living in the United States are not registered with kennel clubs, and many are not even licensed, so it is impossible to know how many dogs from pit bull breeds live, die, or enter the American shelter system each year. We do know that there are a lot of them. Between 1995 and 2005, the most recent time frame for which data are available, a relatively small specialty registry called the American Dog Breeders Association, ADBA, registered more than 700,000 American Pit Bull Terrier puppies. In that same decade, the American Kennel Club, AKC, registered a little more than 25,000 Amstaffs and Staffords. The American Bully Kennel Club, ABKC, another niche organization, currently registers almost 40,000 American Bullies each year, as well as roughly 60,000 dogs from similar bulldog breeds. If the UKC were to make its statistics public, those numbers would add considerably to the total. Combined, these figures still don't account for the untold thousands of purebred dogs whelped in backyards across the United States, or the much higher number of mixed-breed animals who may have one or more pit bull characteristics. In 2011, when the first mutt census was conducted by Mars Veterinary, a research division of the consumer brand Marne Incorporated that sells dog DNA tests, the American Staffordshire Terrier was the seventh most common breed identified in America's mixed-breed dog population, despite being 70th in AKC popularity. The number of Americans who self-identify as pit bull owners is increasing as well. Banfield Pet Hospitals, the largest chain of veterinary clinics in the country, reports that the number of their pit bull-owning clients rose 47% between 2003 and 2013. A separate analysis of national veterinary records lists the American Pit Bull Terrier among the top three most popular breeds in 28 states and among the top five in 34. Once again, we can't know which of these animals are pedigreed pit bulls and which are simply mixed breeds, but this does tell us that the pit bull label is prolific and that many pet owners are quite proud of it. Contrary to the media narrative, only a tiny subset of American pit bulls will ever have any contact with the world of illegal dogfighting, which is a felony in all 50 states. Only a handful of dogs from specific bloodlines of one breed, the American Pit Bull Terrier, are still selected and trained for that purpose. Cruelty investigators at the American Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals, ASPCA, and the Humane Society of the United States, HSUS, report that even within this highly specialized subset, only one dog per litter may show the necessary temperament and stamina for the grim task of mortal combat, which is on par with historical estimates, which placed the number of purpose-bred APBTs matched in pit contests somewhere between 1 and 10%. Therefore, comparing the temperaments and behaviors of elite fighting dogs with those of all pit bulls is a bit like using the U.S. Navy SEALs as a benchmark for all American men. Fortunately for the canine victims involved, law enforcement officials are seeing the number of APBTs bred for fighting dwindle, thanks to increased awareness and tougher enforcement of cruelty laws. They insist that the overwhelming majority of pit bulls, like most dogs in America, live uneventful lives as family pets. You would not know this from reading, watching, or listening to the news. Nor would you know that only about 35 Americans are killed by any type of dog each year, as opposed to the 35,000 who die of accidental overdoses, or the 36,000 who perish in car accidents. Unlike overdoses and car accidents, however, exceedingly rare events, like dog attacks, terrify the most primitive reptilian parts of our brains. And unlike falls or drownings, which also account for thousands of American deaths each year, dog bite deaths, especially when pit bulls are involved, allow the audience to choose sides when looking to place blame. Are pit bulls inherently dangerous, or is it all in how you raise them? Which is more important, human rights or animal rights? Which is stronger, nature or nurture? Like the existence of God, a woman's right to choose, or the ethics of capital punishment, such reductions are good at creating conflict, and conflict drives narrative, which in turn draws viewers and clicks. But they foreclose the possibility of solving the complicated problems of cruelty and violence. Underneath America's need to define a singular truth about pit bulls is a much more revealing division, that pit bulls are not for people like us, the respectable and morally upstanding members of society. Pit bulls belong to them. For the better part of 200 years, the history of bull and terrier dogs was illustrious rather than infamous. Advertisers across the United States clamored to use pit bulls in their campaigns during the 1920s, not because the dogs were believed to be menacing, but because they were thought to be so friendly and appealing to the average Joe. They are the only dogs to have appeared on the cover of Life magazine 3 times, for example. The animal's widespread popularity among people of all ages, races, and classes owed much to their reputations as plucky, unfussy sidekicks and hardy, all-purpose workers. More than that, however, the dog with the patch over his eye was seen as quintessentially American, good-natured, brave, resilient, and dependable. By World War I, pit bulls were so beloved as national symbols that we literally and figuratively wrapped them in the flag. We even called them Yankee Terriers. Haphazardly classified under almost 20 other names over the years, bull and terrier dogs marched onto the field at the Battle of Gettysburg and sniffed out snipers at Normandy. They peeked out of covered wagons bound for California and stumped for women's suffrage. One greeted visitors at New York City's first pizzeria in 1907, while another lived in Teddy Roosevelt's White House. They also accompanied us into the brave new world of modern technology, listening to his master's voice on the recently invented gramophone and riding shotgun in the first cross-country road trip by automobile. Cultural icons as diverse as Sir Walter Scott, William Buffalo Bill Cody, Anna Pavlova, Helen Keller, Jack Dempsey, Jack Johnson, Andy Devine, Roscoe Fatty Arbuckle, Gary Cooper, Douglas Fairbanks, James Thurber, Theodore Dr. Seuss Geisel, and Jimmy Carter proudly kept bull and terrier dogs as pets. And years before anyone heard of a German shepherd named Rin Tin Tin, pit bull actors ruled the silver screen. In fact, Rinty only appeared in 27 motion pictures, while a pit bull named Pal the Wonder Dog appeared in 224. Then, in the 1970s, like a bright light snapping off, everything went terribly wrong. The crime of dogfighting exploded in the headlines, and the well-intentioned, well-publicized crusade to stamp out a barbaric but moribund form of animal torture unwittingly made it more popular. Once reporters and misinformed activists cast the dogs as willing participants in their own abuse, pit bulls were exiled to the most turbulent margins of society, where a cycle of poverty, violence, fear, and desperation had already created a booming market for aggressive dogs. Headlines about pit bull attacks on humans multiplied. Within a few short years, America's century-old love for its former mascot gave way to the presumption that pit bulls were biologically hardwired to kill. A month or so after Sean and I adopted Nola, I met a woman named Lori Hensley. We were standing in line at a local theater making casual conversation when she mentioned that she directed a local nonprofit called the Coalition to Unchain Dogs. The goal of the organization, she said, was to invert the normal paradigm of animal welfare. Instead of removing dogs from, quote, bad homes and placing them with, quote, better families, the group worked to improve the dogs' lives in the homes they already had, thus preventing them from entering the overburdened shelter system in the first place. This was done by providing the dogs' owners with basic veterinary care, spay-neuter surgeries, dog houses, and fenced play areas for their pets, all free of charge. "You should come see what we do," Lori offered. "We can always use more help." I smiled politely and mumbled something lukewarm in response. As noble as the group's objective sounded, I did not consider myself an animal person. In truth, I found certain memes of humane activism, "I love animals but hate people," to be alienating. I also never wanted to see another dog on a chain as long as I lived. My family had owned 9 dogs by the time I was 12. There were 2 dachshunds, 2 Scottish terriers, a golden retriever, a Boykin Spaniel, a Collie, and 2 mutts. None lived with us longer than a few years. Most ended up roaming the neighborhood, where one was hit by a car or chained in the backyard, where one strangled and died. All howled long into the night. Because of this, many of our neighbors viewed us with contempt. We were the family so irresponsible it couldn't take care of its own pets. What my neighbors did not know was that the suffering of the dogs outside our home was a symptom of the suffering inside it. My parents were highly intelligent, generous, and compassionate people, but they were cursed with crippling addictions that numbed their consciences, stunted their ability to make good decisions, and rendered them unable to deal with the responsibilities of everyday life. I was 6 years old when my mother first told me that she had a drug problem, 9 when she was arrested for cocaine possession, 12 when my father's liver failed from years of drinking, and 15 when the failed liver finally killed him. All of us, including the dogs, were casualties of a remorseless disease. Shame and finger-pointing did not solve that problem. "Here's what's interesting, though," Lori said before I was able to change the subject. "I don't do this for the dogs. I do it for the people." Then she mentioned offhand that roughly 80% of her clients owned pit bulls. The first fence build I attended with Lori took place at the mobile home of a woman named Cheryl, who was pregnant with twins at the time. She and her boyfriend owned 3 pit bulls and a chihuahua. 10 volunteers spent roughly 2 hours driving T-posts and pulling welded wire to complete the project. When Cheryl unhooked her dogs from their chains, they shook their giant heads, looked around tentatively, took a few shaky steps, and then started to run, jump, and play for the first time in years, perhaps ever. Cheryl's eyes brimmed with tears as though a crushing weight had finally been lifted. I then began accompanying Lori on her outreach visits, during which she stopped in to see between 12 and 15 clients each Saturday. One family sat on garbage bags of secondhand clothing because they could not afford furniture. Their sewage emptied into the yard through a plastic pipe. Another constructed a sprawling tent city out of old shipping containers and a broken-down bus. Lori sat on porches and beside hospital beds, fussed over newborns, and admired family photographs. It soon became clear that dogs were only a footnote in a much larger community project. "If the coalition leaves any kind of legacy behind," Lori said, "I hope that it is remembered as one of the first animal groups that cared as much about the well-being of the person as it did about the pet." Amanda Arrington, the woman who founded the coalition in 2007, initially focused on the problem of chain dogs as an animal welfare issue. She believed it could be ameliorated with the right resources, namely free fences. When she and Lori began spending more time in the neighborhoods where chain dogs were most common, however, they found systemic social problems that went much deeper. The real enemy was not neglect or cruelty. It was poverty. Residents of lower-income communities, especially those in African-American and Latino neighborhoods, simply did not have access to the same veterinary clinics, pet supply stores, and pet care information that other animal lovers took for granted. This was greatly exacerbated by what the women felt was a reverse Robin Hood mentality in the traditional animal welfare movement that disparaged those who could not spend a great deal of money on their animals. Several of the coalition's clients reported having their companions stolen by well-meaning rescuers who did not realize how much the dog's owners depended on them for emotional support. Other clients were afraid to ask shelter workers or animal control officers for help out of fear that their pets would be taken away. This is the gap the coalition worked to close. Since 2007, the group has unchained 1,885 dogs in 8 cities and spayed or neutered almost 4,000 under Lori's direction. The person Lori visited most often was an 89-year-old woman named Doris. She had recently lost most of her right leg to a foot infection, so she wrapped the stump in a clean cotton sock and pushed herself around in an old manual wheelchair. Doris had lived alone since her husband died in 2000, but every morning she made her bed with crisp hospital corners, scoured her kitchen from top to bottom, and set her dining table for 4, though no one ever joined her for dinner. In her youth, she worked in the curing barns of a company called Central Leaf Tobacco, where she said her boss would regularly ask her to leave work early so that she could come along and clean the house for his wife. On Doris's right cheek was a thin scar that wound its way down to the top of her chest. She told me that many years ago she tried to save her neighbor from being beaten by a drunken, raging husband. The man broke a whiskey bottle on the kitchen table and dragged it across Doris's throat, nearly killing her. Other than Lori and a few volunteers from Meals on Wheels, Doris had no regular visitors until the winter of 2012, when a sickly black pit bull wandered out of the woods behind her house. The dog was old, with nubby yellow teeth, flanks pocked with scabs and sores, and leathery teats that hung so low they almost touched the ground. Fingers of charred flesh ran down the sides of a giant burn scar that spanned the length of her back, and she moved slowly as though dragging a large cinder block behind her. Fearing that the dog would be put to sleep if she called animal control, Doris began cooking grits and eggs for her every morning and wheeling out to the front porch to keep her company. Soon the dog was sleeping in Doris's kitchen, where she answered to a new name, Pretty Girl. If Doris knew or cared that Pretty Girl was a pit bull, she never said so. There was no fretting about breed traits. To Doris, Pretty Girl was just a dog. Over time, I saw dozens of formerly scrawny animals like Pretty Girl transform into sleek, muscular family pets as the bond with their people intensified. But in most cases, the bond had always been there. Better resources just helped it thrive. Nobody wants to keep their dogs on chains, a client named Marlinda told Lori. But sturdy fences were expensive, $500 minimum, and required a great deal of physical work and special equipment to install. Fence recipients were so grateful to be treated with dignity rather than scorn that some became volunteers themselves, spreading information about pet health around their neighborhoods. The unlikeliest of these was a single father and former backyard pit bull breeder named Rodney, who became something of an animal welfare spokesman. At a city council meeting in Durham, North Carolina, Rodney testified that in his neighborhood pets were suffering not because their owners were cruel and depraved, but because the long history of inequality in those areas poisoned everything it touched, including the lives of animals. Referring to his own African-American heritage, he drew a devastating parallel. We used to be in chains, he told the council members. Now our dogs are in chains. Since it ramped up in the 1990s, the marketing of the pit bull as an icon of urban edginess has been incredibly effective. On some streets, every house contained a pit bull, if not 2 or 3. No one I asked could pinpoint when the trend started or why, but it seemed to come down to two concerns, cost and safety. Few families who wanted a dog could afford to spend $500 to $1,000 on a purebred puppy, but pit bulls were always easy to acquire, if not completely free. A number of clients had tried to adopt dogs from local shelters but had been turned away, so they sought out a friend or neighbor whose dog had just given birth. Many other neighborhood pit bulls came from accidental litters or from the local flea market, where truck beds full of cheap puppies were available every weekend. The Great Recession of 2008 had left people even more desperate to make ends meet, and unlike other parts of the underground economy, dog breeding was legal and unregulated. A surprisingly large number of clients, mostly single moms and grandmothers, had taken in animals for friends or family members who lost their jobs, went to prison, or succumbed to terminal illnesses. I met pit bulls that lived in overturned trash cans, in houses made from scraps of wood, in the beds of old trucks, pit bulls that lived with toddlers and with the bedridden elderly, pit bulls that shared close quarters with other dogs, pigs, horses, and chickens, pit bulls that loathed other animals and preferred to be with people. After several hundred of these encounters, I no longer thought of the dogs as belonging to any particular group, let alone a breed. The only thing they shared was that their presence was a comfort and an inspiration to the people around them, to whom the death of a dog, pit bull or otherwise, was mourned as much as, if not more than, the amputation of a limb. Occasionally, I came across the canine bruisers everyone worries about, animals whose wiring just didn't seem right, but each was off-kilter in a different way. Yes, I met two or three pit bulls with nasty dispositions, but also a German shepherd that furiously attacked its own legs when approached, a border collie I was certain would kill me if given the chance, a pug that launched herself at the necks of other dogs near food, and a chow that made even the sturdiest veterinarians cower. As Dr. Laurel Braitman observes in her book Animal Madness, every animal with a mind has the capacity to lose hold of it from time to time. Sometimes the trigger is abuse or maltreatment, but not always. Like ours, the canine brain is far more intricate than a simple nature-nurture debate can clarify. It can be thrown off track by innumerable factors, including shifts in hormones and neurotransmitters, as well as injury and congenital birth defects. Also, like us, many dogs that suffer from these maladies can improve with treatment, but sadly, others cannot. Were the ill-tempered dogs I met born with their screws loose, or had a lifetime of stress mentally worn them down? There was no way of knowing. As one researcher I interviewed explained, nature versus nurture only exists in the media. Everyone in the sciences knows that it's both. I was less surprised by the fraction of unstable animals than by how many dogs, from the smallest chihuahuas to the most imposing Rottweilers, had endured years of deprivation and physical discomfort, yet never lashed out at anyone. Dogs with intestinal blockages or collars embedded in their necks hardly raised a lip or bared a tooth when poked, prodded, or lifted into transport vehicles. It was a powerful testament to the affiliative nature of Canis lupus familiaris as a creature, something we too often look past in a culture so fixated on carnage. Even the most daunting muscle-bound Presa canario is, by virtue of its biology, predisposed to seek out attention from and bond with humans. That is yet another marvel and mystery of the dog. It is the only animal that will place our safety and survival above its own. On one of our Saturday afternoon outings, Lori told me something that I have never forgotten. She said, as long as there are different classes of people, there will be different classes of dogs. And the more I learned about pit bulls, the more it seemed that the dogs and their people had been pushed outside what the philosopher and ethicist Peter Singer calls the expanding circle of compassion. If you looked a certain way and came from a certain neighborhood, your dog was assumed to be a pit bull, or at the very least, a pit mix, and your relationship to it was assumed to be motivated by greed or machismo. Pit bull no longer felt like a physical description to me. it felt like a social caste. To date, pit bulls have been either banned or heavily regulated in more than 850 U.S. communities, including the cities of Miami and Denver, as well as in the Canadian province of Ontario and the entire United Kingdom, among other places. Many public housing projects, apartment complexes, and homeowners associations refuse to allow pit bulls to reside on the premises. Despite the life-saving contributions of a shelter pit bull named Howard, who served multiple tours in Afghanistan with the U.S. Army's 82nd Airborne Division as a tactical explosive detection dog, pit bulls are banned from privatized housing on all major military bases. Several large insurance carriers refuse to underwrite the homes of pit bull owners, and at least one small organization has dedicated itself, with Ahab-like fervor, to eradicating pit bulls and their close mixes altogether, calling them Frankenmaulers, shit bulls, mutants, and undogs. In nearly every municipality where breed-specific legislation, BSL, has been adopted, it has failed to prevent serious dog bite injuries and hospitalizations. Veterinarians, animal behaviorists, and public health experts, including those at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC, are virtually unanimous in their denunciation of BSL on the grounds that it is both cruel and ineffective. In 2013, even the White House released a statement against it. Only the most radical of America's humane groups, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals, PETA, supports this approach. According to the organization's founder, Ingrid Newkirk, the dogs are kept only by drug dealers and pimps. Humane groups estimate that animal shelters around the world kill more than 1 million pit bulls a year. At some facilities, the bodies of dead dogs labeled pit bulls have been piled so high that they resembled sandbag fortresses. The level of collective fury that has been directed against this one group of animals is unprecedented, rivaled only by the annihilation of wolves on the American frontier. It calls to mind what the historian John T. Coleman said about 19th-century wolf hunters, that they seemed to treat their quarry as though it not only deserved death, but deserved to be punished for living. After Hurricane Katrina left thousands of pit bull-type dogs stranded in New Orleans in 2005, and the NFL superstar Michael Vick was convicted on charges related to dogfighting in 2007, America began to reconsider the dog it had once loved so dearly. An ever-growing network of pit bull-focused animal rescues, clubs, and community events sprang up around the country to help promote the dogs as family pets rather than pariahs. At least four reality television shows made pit bull advocacy a primary part of their narratives. Suddenly, millions of Americans were waving the banner of pit bull pride. On Facebook, the interest page for the AKC's most popular breed, the Labrador Retriever, barely tops 400,000 fans. Pit bulls? They have over 4.5 million fans, more than half the number of users interested in dogs as a general subject. Any creature that inspires such strong emotions is destined to be both scapegoated by its enemies and overprotected by its advocates. When this happens, distortions, fables, and half-truths can run in both directions. In February 2014, for example, a four-year-old boy named Kevin Vicente wandered into a neighbor's yard in Phoenix, Arizona, where a dog named Mickey was chained. According to Vicente's babysitter, the little boy picked up Mickey's bone, and the dog bit him badly on the face, breaking Vicente's jaw and one of his eye sockets. Doctors said that the boy would need several reconstructive surgeries, but he would always be permanently disfigured and blind in one eye. Mickey's owner willingly released him to animal control officers, and everyone expected that due to the severity of the injury he caused, the dog would be humanely euthanized. Instead, a massive social media campaign converged to save Mickey. The Lexis Project, a New York-based legal defense fund for animals, arranged for the dog to have his own legal representation. If the child had been fully supervised, Mickey's supporters said, he probably would not have been bitten. While that is undoubtedly true, Team Mickey came across as cold and callous when its members took to social media to heap blame on Vicente's caretakers, even on Kevin himself. Everybody is taught from the moment they walk, you do not take a bone from a dog, the attorney representing Mickey told a reporter. The official report from the county shelter, however, didn't mention a bone. The events of that day are still unclear, but the dog supporters vowed online that they would save poor confused Mickey, who is being punished for doing what dogs do and what children should be taught not to. That Mickey was described as a pit bull stoked this fire considerably, with animal advocates insisting that he was being persecuted because of his appearance. According to the local sheriff's department, more than 50,000 supporters petitioned the judge presiding over Mickey's disposition to spare the animal, even if he couldn't be placed in another home. Joe Arpaio, the notoriously bombastic local sheriff, then offered Mickey a permanent residence at the Maricopa County Jail's no-kill shelter, the Animal Safe Haven. Today, while human inmates in Arpaio's jail are consigned to outdoor tents in the stifling Arizona heat, where temperatures inside can rise to 145 degrees Fahrenheit, Mickey now lives alone in his own air-conditioned cell, complete with a $1,000 webcam, where he will be isolated more than 23 hours a day for the rest of his life. Mickey's fans are ecstatic that he will remain alive, but at what cost? When meted out to humans, a lifetime of solitary confinement is considered psychological torture, and dogs, like humans, rely on regular social contact for their overall well-being. As the Save Mickey saga played out in the press, the support fund for Kevin Vicente's medical bills raised less than $2,500. Numerous columnists, journalists, and bloggers around the country, including me, were disturbed by the lack of concern about the boy's recovery. Others used the battle over Mickey's fate to condemn all pit bull dogs and portray their owners as borderline sociopaths. The Save Mickey campaign followed a pattern typical of the pit bull wars. It devolved into demagoguery, with the protagonists reduced to caricatures and straw men. Whose suffering took priority? Whose compassion outweighed whose? Perhaps this tempest should not surprise us. There may be no creature on earth that lends itself to as much love, hate, and myth-making as the domestic dog. There is no animal that our culture is more invested in, no animal with whom we spend more of our lives, no animal that we see as a truer extension of ourselves. In the 35,000 years since we entered the interspecies partnership that made civilization possible, the literature of dogs has mostly become a literature of longing for home, for safety, for acceptance, and probably for some flicker of the wildness we ourselves have lost. The magic that gleams an instant between Argos and Odysseus is both the recognition of diversity and the need for affection across the illusions of form, noted the anthropologist and science writer Lauren Isley, alluding to the final books of Homer's epic, The Odyssey. After 20 years apart, the eponymous warrior's dog recognizes him when his human family cannot. That look of recognition, Isley says, is nature's cry to homeless, far-wandering, insatiable man. Do not forget your brethren, nor the green wood from which you sprang. To do so is to invite disaster. Yet our ambivalence toward the dog runs as deeply as our love for it in both our minds and our myths. One has only to look at the sheer number of canine monsters that romp through our nightmares. For every faithful Argos, there is a knife-toothed Cerberus guarding the gates of Hades. For every Toto, there is a Baskerville hound charging across the moors, its eyes glowing with phosphorus. For every Lassie, there's a Cujo. Dogs that remind us they are animals rather than surrogate humans do so at their own peril. For whatever reason, our culture has transformed the dog into a paragon of canine virtue, writes the behaviorist Dr. James Serpell, director of the Center for the Interaction of Animals and Society at the University of Pennsylvania School of Veterinary Medicine. He is our loyal and faithful servant and companion, a sort of amiable culture hero whose friendship is proverbially better than that of our fellow humans. That such a devoted and trusted admirer should suddenly turn and savage one of us is both frightening and disturbing. For not only is this behavior disloyal, a betrayal of trust, it is also grossly insubordinate. As perpetual children, we expect dogs to be forever innocent, playful, and fun-loving. A murderous dog, like a murderous child, is therefore nothing less than an abomination, a disturbance in the natural order, an unacceptable threat to the perceived security and stability of the entire community. The chaos of wildness is unnerving on its own, but more so when a creature that manifests it sleeps in our beds. In order to make sense of a confusing, chaotic world, the French anthropologist Claude Lévi-Strauss believed that we divide the landscape into strict binaries and opposing forces: good, evil, black, white, hero, monster, us, them. Knowing how to categorize things puts ground under our feet when we are frightened by uncertainty. Dogs fit perfectly into this divided portrait. We are always looking at two dogs, in a sense: the physical dog in front of us, the one with the particular brain and heart who likes to eat popcorn or likes to play frisbee, and the character in a much larger story we have been telling ourselves about dogs for thousands of years. We embroider this narrative with personal anecdotes, hopes, fears, rumors, gossip, received wisdom, and the constant drone of modern media. But the story is an ever-evolving fiction. Often it has little, if anything, to do with the flesh-and-blood animal looking back. One of the most famous relics from the doomed city of Pompeii is a mosaic from the house of the tragic poet. It depicts a ferocious guard dog gnashing its teeth. Cave canem, it warns, beware of the dog. Just across the way, at the house of a local official named Versonius Primus, the preserved remains of an actual guard dog that perished in the destruction were also found. Chained to its post by a bronze-studded collar, the animal was unable to escape the volcano's wrath. As the dog writhed in agony, the lava and ash that overwhelmed it froze the creature in time as a symbol of pathos, not violence. Yet it is almost always the first dog, the one with teeth bared, that we remember. Fears about demon dogs have cycled through Anglophone culture for hundreds of years, but none has endured as long as the controversy over pit bulls, which is now entering its fifth decade. Nor has any been fed by as much bad science, media sensationalism, political brinkmanship, moral panic, racial venom, or class prejudice. The most inconvenient thing about obsessions is that they never announce themselves. One day you make a simple decision to adopt a shelter dog, and the next you find yourself building fences and visiting elderly pet owners in their hospital rooms. 5 years later, your whole life has been consumed by the need to understand how the American pit bull became an American boogeyman. What is it about pit bulls that ignites such strong feelings? And what does that mean for us as a society? The mascot came to be viewed as a monster, not because dogs changed, but because we did. Or rather, because we failed to. Chapter 2. The Keep. Was there one created living thing that had no quitting point? And was that thing the bulldog? Ralph G. Kirk, White Monarch and the Gas House Pup. Standing in the cold shadow of the Brooklyn Bridge, the four-story brick Georgian at 273 Water Street is the third oldest building in Manhattan. Built as a family residence and sold to a mahogany trader named Joseph Rose in 1773, it features shiny brass address plates and a smart colonial facade that springs up from the cobblestones. Modern realtors describe the Rose House as charming, quaint, and untouched by time, asking more than $1 million for each of the building's four two-bedroom condos. From at least 1863 to 1870, however, the bottom floor of the Rose House served as the euphemistically named Sportsman's Hall, a saloon that fronted the country's most notorious dog pit. The proprietor of Sportsman's Hall was a bawdy, mutton-chopped Hibernian named Christopher Keyburn, who preferred the nickname Kit Burns to the moniker given to him by the newspapers, the cruelest man in New York. He arrived on the city's crowded docks as a barefoot, penniless teenager sometime around 1845, one of 7.5 million Irish immigrants who fled the starvation and disease of the potato famines during the mid-19th century. Like many of his countrymen, Burns landed in the roiling cauldron of the Five Points neighborhood in Lower Manhattan, roughly the same area as Chinatown today, where he maneuvered so artfully that he later became a folk hero among the city's Irish underclass. When he died in 1870 at the age of 39, a large crowd of mourners braved the December chill to walk alongside Burns's horse-drawn hearse as it made the 10-mile journey from Brooklyn to Queens. The Five Points at mid-century was a carnival of human misery, and heroes were hard to come by. Refugees who left their home countries believing that America's streets were paved with gold spent their nights huddled together in overcrowded tenement apartments that regularly caught fire and incinerated the inhabitants. Children younger than 10 years old labored in the city's sweatshops, with no laws to protect them from being beaten, starved, or maimed by machinery. Sewage collected in the streets and runoff from the stockyards poisoned the drinking water, allowing cholera and typhoid, not to mention the ever-present threat of tuberculosis, to wash across the community in noxious waves. The streets teemed with so much filth, in fact, that nurses and doctors making emergency house calls hurried along the rooftops rather than brave the sidewalks. "Lower than the Five Points," wrote the Scandinavian feminist Fredrika Bremer, "it is not possible for human nature to sink." Native-born New Yorkers found the mannerisms and traditions of poor Irish immigrants revolting. They called them white Negroes and depicted them as drunken, subhuman apes in political cartoons, which made it even more difficult for the newcomers to succeed in legitimate professions. In 1857, one newspaper correspondent asserted that the children of Irish Catholics are growing up in ignorance, in squalid poverty, in vicious habits, and the chances are that 9/10 of them will become thieves, prostitutes, depredators upon society, and inmates of our jails. The only semblance of law and order that existed in Lower Manhattan was shakily maintained by the gangs that patrolled the streets. The largest of these was the Roche, or Roach, Guard, which the press insisted on calling the Dead Rabbits. Members of the Guard strong-armed local politicians, rigged city elections, and settled disputes with iron bars and brickbats. If you flourished in the Five Points, as Kit Burns eventually did, you did so by criminal means. But to be a rough, as they were known, was to be further dehumanized. The facial and cranial appearance of the rough goes far to establish the truth of physiognomy and phrenology, wrote the journalist Junius Henri Brown in 1869. All the animal is in the shape of his features and head, but the semblance of the thinking, cultivated, self-disciplined man is very nearly lost. Gang life began for Burns not long after his arrival in America, when he gravitated toward a saloon called the Sawdust House. It was run by a hard-boiled Irish pugilist named James Ambrose, more commonly known as Yankee Sullivan. Bare-knuckle boxing was illegal in New York at the time, but Sullivan's criminal allegiances allowed him to conduct his exhibitions with little concern about police intervention. Unlike the regulated sport of boxing today, clandestine bare-knuckle matches during the 1850s were so violent that one party might be permanently paralyzed or even beaten to death. Burns often worked as a corner man for these bouts, but he was much more interested in Sullivan's sideshow entertainments, the rat baits, in which small terriers attempted to kill dozens of live rats in a given period, and the dogfights, most of all. Years later, Burns would wistfully recall that his time at Sullivan's Tavern instilled in him a lifelong obsession with fighting dogs, which he called his love for animals. The bloodletting inside the pit was, he thought, much milder than the human struggle for survival in the Five Points. Outside the tavern door, you lived with your fists up, or you didn't live at all. At least the dogs were fed and kept warm at night. That was a great deal more than most of his neighbors could secure for themselves. Dogs will fight, he liked to say, for 'tis their nature to. In Burns's native British Isles, a dark romance had grown up around fighting dogs and, by extension, around the men who loved them, the romance of the gladiator. This was especially true in the industrial moonscape of the English Midlands, an area so pocked with coal mines and choked with smog that it became known as the Black Country. The more downtrodden parts of Ireland and Wales had their share of fighters as well. Anywhere men slaved away in foundries or coal pits, there you would find fighting dogs. Some of the dogs were so critical as family breadwinners that orphaned pups were suckled at human breasts. The courage and fight of the Black Country man was his only asset, writes the historian Mike Homan. The manner of meeting death was also important. It was only acceptable to go down fighting, this being as vital as victory. By no means did the Britons invent this idea. Many civilizations have used animal fighting as a proxy for human conflict. Both Miltiades, the Athenian general whose army routed the Persians at the Battle of Marathon in 490 BCE, and Themistocles, the Athenian general who again triumphed over the Persians at the Battle of Salamis 10 years later, were said to have required their troops to watch cockfights before battle. According to one chronicler, Greek military strategists believed nothing produces a greater incentive to improve one's own behavior than seeing a lowly creature reach a height of achievement beyond our own aspirations. Roman rulers held paired combats between exotic animals imported from the hinterlands of the empire and also venations, or elaborate staged hunts, during which thousands of animals might be slaughtered in a single day. But after watching these for several years, Roman citizens clamored for more thrilling entertainments. Roman magistrates then devised death by wild beast as a primary method of capital punishment. Bestiarii, as the condemned criminals were known, were stripped naked, bound to a column of shame upon which their offenses had been inscribed, then devoured by starved, agitated predators until, in the words of Marshall, they no longer had the semblance of a body. By that yardstick, the English medieval spectacle of bull baiting, from which the bulldog earned its name, was a few steps down on the ladder of sadism, but only a few. In the days before enclosures, cattle grazed freely in communal pastures, and keeping a herd together was quite challenging. Livestock that decided to go for a ramble might be stolen, destroy property, injure themselves, or, in the case of headstrong bulls, kill passers-by with nothing more than a quick toss of the head. Farmers who tried to chase them down risked being gored or stomped to death, but farm dogs, specifically large guardian types called mastiffs, could easily subdue the stragglers. It was not expected, and certainly not desired, that the dogs would maul, maim, or kill an animal as highly valued as a bull. They only had to grip its hide and keep it stationary until someone else arrived to yoke it. By the 13th century, owning at least one catch dog was considered essential for farmers, butchers, drovers, and anyone else who hunted or worked with cattle for a living. This necessity grew as England, the nation of beef eaters, expanded its meat production. Butchers soon made a bloody but cost-effective discovery. If they allowed their catchdogs to worry a tethered bull that was past its mating prime, the lactic acid produced as the bull exerted itself would soften its muscles, making otherwise inedible meat tender enough for sale. For a time, English law required that bulls be baited before slaughter. This practice developed into a popular type of gambling in which spectators bet on which creatures outlasted the others. Bull baiting in England, like bull fighting in Spain, soon became a national institution, like dancing around the maypole or beating the parish bounds, in the words of the historian James Turner. The Tudors transformed the size and scope of baiting spectacles by swapping out bulls for bears, most of which were imported from Russia. Queen Elizabeth, in particular, was said to have been so delighted by the sight of dogs attacking a restrained bear that she giggled like a schoolgirl during the events, during which she hosted many foreign dignitaries. Bear gardens sprouted up all over London, and it is even possible that Shakespeare's Globe Theatre was modeled on this type of baiting arena. While there was more than enough suffering to go around, modern references to Renaissance animal baiting tend to omit that the dogs were almost always on the losing end of the equation. As many as a dozen mastiffs and their smaller replacements, the bulldogs, could be gored, swatted, bitten, or stomped to death during a single bait. Most citizens refused to send their working animals to meet an almost certain death, so a representative of the crown traveled the countryside, conscripting villagers' dogs into service. He was so unpopular that when he arrived, commoners often hurled rotten fruit at him. When it first stepped out of the historical record in 1609, the bulldog was a healthy, athletic, well-proportioned animal. It bore no physical resemblance to the modern English bulldog, whose shape has been contorted dramatically for bench show novelty. The common belief that today's bulldog has a flattened face so that the blood of a pinned bull can sluice down its wrinkles, for example, is a myth. It is inconceivable to most Westerners that any animals, especially dogs, could have been treated with such callous disregard, but this was the age of witch trials and the Spanish Inquisition, when public whippings and executions of criminals were widely attended as entertainment, and transgressors could be drawn and quartered in the public square, disemboweled, or even boiled to death for minor infractions. Meaningful discussions about animal protection did not gain momentum during the Middle Ages because...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.